And so now, yeah, Shane Collins going to talk to us about Green Party policy for licensing and, would you call it legalising drugs, Shane? We'll hear from Shane.
How's this one? Is this microphone good? Yes, lovely. So, afternoon. Thank you very much for coming and hopefully sitting still for sitting still for an hour or two. Going to have a fairly broad-ranging talk this afternoon, looking at... Oh, I've just cut my nose, haven't I?
On the mic. Speak up, so
excuse me, I just cut my nose on the mic. Well, dynamic talk already, I haven't even started. So I want to talk about sort of broadly the effects of drug prohibition, in particular looking at the effects of cannabis prohibition. And I want to sort of break it down into a few parts, looking at the problems of prohibition. On one hand, there's sort of the civil liberties problem side of it. On the other hand, there's the corruption side of it. Obviously, if you prohibit something for which there's a demand, all you're doing is creating a criminal market. So the possibilities of corruption are endless. The crime as a result of the buying and selling and the taking of Class A drugs in particular. And then lastly, I want to come on to how it could be. You know, how a better system of regulation could be. Looking at how it is in a few other countries around the world and then looking at the different party policies here. So, let's start off looking at the three problems of prohibition. First of all, I think the basic thing of civil liberties. You know, the basis of most of our law in this country, I think is Edmund Burke, that you're free to do whatever you want to do, so long as you don't impinge on other people's freedoms. And if you do impinge on other people's freedoms, then the state or your friends or whoever has a reason for getting involved and protecting the smaller person from the bigger crime. That's not really the case with drug use. People obviously take drug use for many different reasons, but most of it is for fun and recreation. And that's not really doing anybody any harm. So I think it's questionable from that basic civil liberties point of view of why should there be prohibition of something that is not harmless, but it's people doing harm by and large to themselves if there is harm being done. So that's not necessarily where the state should get involved. And how does the effects on civil liberties come about mostly in reaction, in sort of interaction with the state? It's stop and search. You know, that is how the majority of people in urban areas come into contact with the state, with the police, through drug use, through stop and search. Hands up who's been stopped and searched. So that's, I'd say, around a quarter to a half. I think if we were in an inner city area, that percentage would be far, far higher. And it is a bit like sort of shooting fish in a barrel, stop and search in London. I was involved with the Lambeth Community Police Group for too many years, which was sort of came out of the Scarman report into the Brixton riots, which is supposed to be the interface between the cops and the community. So if there was any problems, it would come to the consultative group as opposed to immediately a riot. But we did a lot of research into stop and search in London. And of people who are stopped and searched, about 9% were actually arrested. So 91% of people just stopped and searched, done nothing wrong. Of that 9% of arrested, only half, about 4.5%, were actually charged. So 95% of those stop and searches, people entirely innocent, only 5% did they get charged, and then the police can't actually find out what the results of that 5% are going through the legal system, whether they were guilty or not guilty. So it's really a recipe for antagonism between the people who are stopped and searched and the police. And I should think, you know, that resonates with a lot of people, particularly in urban areas, particularly people ethnic minorities who the police tend to target anyway for various reasons. But in about 70% of the reasons given for a stop and search, it's, I think you've got some drugs on you, Sonny. Okay, it used to be the sus laws, I think you've just been involved in a burglary, and heavy use of that led to the riots in Brixton and Toxteth and various other places. Now it's, I think you might have some drugs on you. You look young and hoodie or whatever it is. So now that's another way in which people's civil liberties are being impinged upon and creating distance between the police and broadly young people. And this is a big problem because we've got a fairly traumatic few decades ahead in our society as we sort of transition away from fossil fuels into a solar-based economy. And unless we do it right, equally, it's going to be pretty nasty. And we don't want to have the police at odds with a large percentage of the younger population. So there are many other examples of the problems involving civil liberties, but let's go on to corruption. Now, I said before, if you prohibit something for which there is a demand, all you do is create a criminal market. And the drug trade, according to the UN, I think was the third biggest trade in the world. Oil was the biggest trade, arms, second biggest trade, and illegal drugs were the third biggest trade in the world. So there's a lot of possibilities for dodgy dealings with all that unaccounted money swirling around. So I want to look at how that corruption affects society on three different levels. First of all, on a sort of governmental level. Secondly, on a more sort of local level involving the police, and thirdly, on a sort of community level. So with all this illegal money sloshing around, being unaccountable, it allows the owners of that great power. And it's interesting, it was mentioned actually in Tony's talk, the world banking system in the bailout in 2009, what do you think saved the economy then? Suddenly, governments lent millions and millions of pounds and dollars. I want to read you a quote from the head of the UN Drug and Crime Office, a chap called Antonio Maria Costa, head of the UN Office on Drugs and Crime. He said that the proceeds of organized crime were the only liquid investment capital available to some banks on the brink of collapse in 2008-2009. He said that a majority of the $352 billion of drugs profits were absorbed into the economic system as a result. Okay, and some of you be familiar with what HSBC were doing with the Sinaloa cartel in Mexico. Tony alluded to it earlier on. In the banks in Mexico, rather like the banks here, when you go in to see the bank teller, you have these slides that where you put your payments through. The Sinaloa cartel had measured up the slides where you put your money through. They measured it up exactly. Every day they would bring in a block of about $200,000 that fitted exactly through the hole into the teller. And they did this every day for weeks, months, years. Now, this was a bank that was owned by HSBC, obviously one of Britain's biggest banks, very, very deeply involved in British establishment. And it transpired that they had laundered $376 billion. From the Sinaloa cartel, Chapo Guzman, the geezer who's just escaped from a big prison tunnel in Mexico. And Antonio Maria Costa, the head of UN Drug and Crime, is saying that when the banks had all seized up, they wouldn't lend to each other. It was this $376 billion that suddenly got released into the world banking system that actually gave the banking system some liquidity and allowed it to carry on. So it wasn't a crash, it was just a bailout. So you'd think that HSBC might get ticked off when this eventually came out in The Guardian a few years later. And the US authorities fined HSBC $1.9 billion. No fist handcuffs or anything like that. It was just a fine of probably a couple of weeks' profit of HSBC. The chief executive of HSBC at the time, Stephen Green, does anybody know what he now does? Government minister. He went on from HSBC to become government minister, and now he's in the House of Lords. The head of compliance at HSBC, Rona Fairhead, is now... So, you know, let's go back to the first head of the BBC Trust. So all these people deeply involved at the highest level of HSBC who, you know, they really can't say they didn't know that $200,000 cash a day were coming in from a nice looking chap in Mexico. There cannot have not been suspicions. Yeah, just a small fine and be a government minister. So I bring these points up because with this all this illegal money sloshing around, the possibilities for corruption are huge. That's recently to do with the banks. Going back a few years to the early 80s in America, the link between the CIA and the Contras in Nicaragua. Just to take you back to them, when the Sandinistas were in power in Nicaragua, the Americans were funding the right-wing terrorists, the right-wing in Nicaragua, against the Sandinistas. In 1982, the US Congress said that the Contras were a pretty nasty bunch of right-wing murderers, we won't fund them anymore. So the CIA found alternative ways of providing them funding. And what they did is they allowed cocaine dealers who were bringing around 200 tons of cocaine a year up from Central and South America into the southern United States, particularly into Los Angeles. The CIA allowed this to happen so long as the profits were going back to the Contras. It's rather the same tactics they use with the Mujahideen in Afghanistan, the Golden Triangle, these sort of places with the KMT during Vietnam. Illegal and drug money and lots of it allows governments to do the things they want to do, but not in a public way. Just to go on with the story which Gary Webb from the San Jose Chronicle exposed entirely and made all the links between the drugs coming into a key man in Los Angeles called Ricky Fairway Ross, who passed it on to the black gangs, the Bloods and the Crips in Los Angeles, and through the Bloods and the Crips, it went to every black ghetto in every city in North America, and led to huge, huge amounts of violence, turf wars, and obviously then cocaine being cut into crack cocaine, more extreme profits, more extreme reactions. And it got to the stage in the 80s where, you know, a few blocks away from the White House in Washington, D.C., you were having gangs with bazookas arguing over turf wars. And this led to Clinton bringing in the three strikes, mandatory seven-year sentences, which led to the American prison population ballooning to around 2 million people, of which about 800,000 were for drugs. So... as a result of that corrupt practices of the CIA allowing these dealers to bring huge profits in on the understanding that some of the money went back to the Contras to fight against the Sandinistas in Nicaragua, this led to the decimation of most black inner city ghettos in the States. horrendous crime rate, people feeding a habit, this sort of thing. And the other thing the CIA did was put them in contact with arms sellers, the dealers with arms sellers, so that they could take the arms back to the Contras and to South America. And then obviously they appeared all over American cities as well. And Gary Webb, God rest his soul, a very, very fearless journalist, won the Pulitzer Prize for his expose of the story. His book is called The Dark Alliance, The CIA, Crack Cocaine and the Contras. He sadly died a couple of years ago in mysterious circumstances. He lost his job. He was ostracized by the establishment when it became clear what was happening. The CIA did their own report into it called the HITS report, and in a masterful piece of PR, on the day that Clinton's impeachment proceedings were going on in Congress to do with Monica Lewinsky, the CIA just slipped out the HITS report saying, yes, well, actually, we were in contact with about 56 dealers, and we did know what they were doing, and that's how it was. So his book is being made into a film, Gary Webb, Dark Alliance. I'd highly recommend seeing it. I've not seen the film, but the book is dynamite. The other aspect of corruption on a more sort of local level involves policing. And there was a really illuminating story I heard when I went to the States on... John was saying I was involved with the Cannabis March and Festivals from 1999 to 2004. Because London was sort of seen as quite the biggest march and festival, and we had a march and then a huge festival afterwards, we were quite fated in New York by Cures Not Wars and people from the Black Panthers who sort of set up the Cannabis marches. And in 99 to early 2000s, they were going off in about 360 cities around the world. It was quite a big movement. But I went over there to help out in the NADA campaign and to take posters around the states to all the cities who were putting on their marches. And talking to some old yippies, and we were talking about the crime rates in Washington. And he was contrasting it with the crime rates in Chicago, where Chicago, you know, traditionally mafia city, Richard Daley, all that sort of thing, a pretty corrupt police force compared to Washington, D.C., center of the federal capital and all that sort of thing, a very uncorrupt police force. The net result was that in Chicago, because the police just wanted things easy, they didn't want any outbreaks of violence or whatever, they basically put up with the drug gangs, the turf war, the turfs, and just let them, everybody get on with it, so long as there weren't turf wars. And so Chicago, relatively non-violent, unviolent in terms of the drug trade and the battles over it, in contrast with Washington State, where the police were less corrupt, much more on it, constantly busting gangs, lots and lots of turf wars being fought, as I say, with bazookas a few blocks away from the White House and lots of other stuff, a far higher crime rate because of the non-corruptible police, in a weird sort of way. Let's also have a look at the police here. I mean, let's just go back to the Stephen Lawrence murder. I don't know if any of you read Private Eye. Who reads Private Eye? Do you think that it is the best source of dirt that's going on? I mean, I really, if people are interested in keeping up with what's going on, a subscription to Private Eye is 23 quid a year or whatever it is. It's just the best. But anyway, they expose the Stephen Lawrence story first, and in particular the goings on at Eltham Police Station. Just to take you back, on the night Stephen Lawrence was murdered, there was three or four phone calls to the police, eyewitness reports saying it was these people, Acourt, Norris, various different people. Eltham Police Station took the calls, did nothing about it. Took 2 weeks to search these people's houses, these five people who were in the frame. And it was a classic botched investigation. It later transpired that David Norris, father of one of the Norris boys who was later accused, big time Southeast London criminal, heavily involved in drugs, was very involved with the Eltham Police Station and was photographed by a customs and excise sting looking into police corruption, handing over envelopes to one of the investigating officers of the Stephen Lawrence report case in an Eltham pub. So the point without, there's lots of other details that are gradually coming out in this, and more recently we heard that there was an undercover copper involved in the Stephen Lawrence campaign. It also transpired that the Metropolitan Police didn't release the documents to McPherson when he was doing his report about police corruption. So McPherson's report concluded that the police were simply racist. What it didn't conclude, because the documents were withheld by the police, was that it was also not totally institutionally corrupt, but certainly at Eltham Police Station, it was institutionally corrupt. Officers were taking bribes from criminals, one of them who was the son of one of the accused. The other way it sort of corrupts our society on a more local level is these constant things about shopping your neighbours, about cannabis grow farms, about neighbours taking drugs. This sort of insecurity that builds up in a community where sometimes you don't really trust your neighbours because you're not quite sure what's going on, and especially if you've been burgled. Hands up who's been burgled at home. In lots of areas, urban areas in particular, it's many more, but one of Tony Blair's policy units looked into the causes of crime in Britain, and they found that 57% of all crime in Britain was essentially due to Class A drug use. So it's about 80% of burglaries and thefts, but you know, 57% of all crimes in the country was people about trying to feed a drug habit. So if you've been mugged or burgled or broken into, you know, you think, oh, who's that? You don't trust people quite so much. And we need to have cohesive communities. For, as I was saying before, the next few decades are going to be pretty traumatic as we move away from fossil fuels towards carbon, and hopefully the old oligarchies that come with centralized energy production go away. I mean, it's so simple, isn't it? If you have our society depends on energy. If you have centralized energy production, you have centralized economics, because everybody's paying 200 quid a month to the electricity company. And if you have centralized economics, you have centralized politics. But if you have decentralized politics, i.e. we're all providing our own power, we're not paying 200 quid a month to the man, to the electricity company, then you get decentralized economics, and then you get decentralized politics. It really is that simple. You have to realize how our society works. And for the last 150 years, we've been drinking in this geological freak of nature that has somehow stored billions and billions of years of ancient sunlight into, you know, a petrol can, a gallon of petrol. That's 300 man hours of energy. It's an amazing freak of nature. And we're just pissing it up against the wall. It should be revered and kept for future generations, kept for emergencies, you know, as we move into an area of free energy, of cheap energy, of energy that comes from current sunlight as opposed to ancient sunlight. But anyway, I'm digressing a bit. But it's important to have cohesive communities with, you know, no concerns about being shot to the cops, no less muggings, burglaries, this sort of thing. Excuse me. I talked a little bit about crime, the effects of drug use on individuals and the crime that they then commit to feed that habit. Also, gangs, drug gangs, you know, most London estates are run by gangs, and at the apex of those gangs, it's about running weed, and then there's little soldiers down the line who do this. Cannabis is such a popular drug that the money to be made from it is there, and if it can't happen legally, it will happen illegally. And so, since disputes can't be settled through the small claims courts, you know, you end up in little gangs and, you know, high sales of baseball bats and low sales of baseballs. And what's that all about? Another, when I was doing a bit of research on this, one of the most dastardly examples of criminal gangs using technology to further their aims. Now, we're talking about computers here, and we have these huge concerns about giving information to corporations and to governments and this sort of thing. An example from way back in Mexico in 1994, the Cali cartel got hold of a huge IBM supercomputer, and they managed to get the phone numbers of all the DEA agents in Mexico, bribing somewhere along the way. But anyway, they got the phone numbers of all these DEA agents, and then they bought the entire phone records of Mexico illegally off the telecommunications companies in Mexico. And with this huge supercomputer, they went through all the records, and basically any numbers that connected to the DEA, DEA officers' phone numbers, they concluded that who would a DEA officer be ringing? It would only be an informer. And so through this method, the Cali cartel were able to stamp out on any informers, anybody who had any contact with these DEA agents. And quite simply, they would get the computer to do the work, find out who the number was, who owned the number, and assassinate them. And so that's how, you know, a highly nasty, nasty drug cartel, the Cali cartel in Mexico, as brutal as you like, that's how they used technology to further their ends. And I think we know that probably most South American countries, governments didn't come to power without the financial support, hush hush of course, of the big drug dealers. And lots of times it was the drug cartels supporting one candidate against the other. So I'm probably laboring the point, and I'll repeat it again, but you know, if you prohibit something for which there's a demand, all you do is create a criminal market with all these problems that come from it. The problems of corruption on a sort of supranational level with corporations and governments, on a more middling level with police forces, and then on a more local level on the community side of it. So I hope I've tried to outline the problems of prohibition. So I want to quickly look at how it is in other countries now. And what time am I on, John?
You've got 25 minutes.
25 minutes, okay. So after years of drugs campaigners banging heads against brick walls, really, it seemed, suddenly in the last few years there is a lot of movement on drug regulation around the world and drug control around the world. And ironically, it sort of not started, but it's really flowered in the last few years in the United States, which was obviously the birth of prohibition and Henry J. Anslinger and loads of dodgy links with DuPont and hemp. And I'm sure if you've read the hemp Bible, I won't go into it in too much detail. But amazingly, through the American states having referendums, there's now two states in America, Colorado and Washington State, where cannabis is completely legally sold. It's been going for just over a year now, and the state of Colorado and Washington absolutely loves it. The crime associated with gangs has gone, huge money flowing into the states, huge tax returns, loads of small businesses, loads of employment. What's not to like? And there's referendums coming in many other states, and medical marijuana is now, I think it's probably about 20, 25 states. The federal government has at last said that medical marijuana is an individual state issue and not a federal issue. And most excitingly, the UN drug laws, drug convention, which was always positioned as this is the way that, this is the reason national governments can't change policies because of the UN Drug Convention. They have at last announced, as a result of what's been going on in the United States, that the laws are a slightly movable feast. They can be interpreted by individual countries according to their individual situations. Obviously, Holland was the main change, and that was sort of, I think, late 70s, when Holland realized they had a very bad drug problem, a lot of heroin addiction in particular and crime associated with it. So they decided they had to separate supply from cannabis, which was the biggest drug being sold. About 80% of it was cannabis. A separate supply from the heroin, which was a real big problem. So they licensed cannabis cafes very strictly. You couldn't advertise, you couldn't have a leaf on the outside, but you had to provide point of sale information, strength, where it's from, this sort of thing. And if you sold anything other than cannabis, you'd lose your license. incredibly successful. You know, the crime rate dropped, and the crime rate in Holland is about half what it is here. And you know, because we have twice as high a crime rate than Holland, because we have a crap drug laws, we have a lot more crime, we have a lot more policing, we have a lot more divisive society. We're wasting, I think it's about £19 billion a year in court time, police time, prison time, dealing with drug effect offenders. When you know the alternative, as was shown in Holland and now in the States, is you know, more employment, less crime, more state income in the form of taxation. So you know, it's such a no-brainer. And we've got the bloody neoconservative thinking conservatives looking to slash the welfare state, that sort of gift of our grandparents' generation. Their flower after the Second World War is now being decimated by these people who think that private business can run things better, and they say they have to do this to save money for the state. You know, just change the drug laws is a very simple way that you could save about £19 billion a year in all this police, court, prison time. So you know, logically, intellectually, I think the argument has been well won. But trying to get politicians who, you know, by and large, politics in Britain is about the middle 15% of swing voters because of our ridiculous first-past-the-post system. It's only sort of 100, 150, maybe 200 seats that swing that make the difference, and that's the middle 15% who broadly are small-scale conservatives, families, express reading, mail reading. These are the swing voters that change governments under a first-past-the-post system. And basically politicians, conventional politicians, are too scared to offend them by talking about changes to the drug laws. And so we're stuck in this ridiculous situation where all these politicians admit privately it's ridiculous, but publicly they don't dare. And I say I was involved with the Lambeth Community Police Consultative Group for 10 years. Over that time, there was three London borough commanders of Lambeth who, you know, off the record, in fact, whilst having a pee after a meeting, two of them said, "Yeah, I actually quite agree with what you're saying, but yeah, I can't say the problem." You know, these are proper police officers who can see what's going on, but they daren't step out of line. And Paddock was an interesting example, the commander in Lambeth who did step out of line. All he actually did was formally said what inner city police forces have been doing for a long time, was just chucking away small amounts of cannabis and trying to focus on smack and crack. He said that formally. The Home Office were absolutely terrified, thought, God, what can we do? He got a really good reception locally. And so they couldn't, well, they kept him on for a bit, and then they moved him sideways once the Mail on Sunday had done a sting with his ex-lover and paid him, the ex-lover, 120 grand to say Paddock had smoked cannabis. And the Home Office then panicked, moved Paddock sideways. But, you know, the Lambeth pilot flew and led to reclassification, which was an extremely confusing thing going from B to C, because it sort of said, well, it's not such a big problem to smoke it, but you still can't buy it. So, you know, you can eat food, you just can't buy food. So it was a ridiculous halfway house that has since been rescinded by Gordon Brown and the Labour government, that sort of arch-Puritan who was getting very worried when people were having a better time than he was and thought, right, we've got to reclassify it back again. Other examples of interesting stuff going on, Uruguay, legalised system, Jamaica legalised for sort of an ounce or two of personal possession. So worldwide, it really is changing quite a bit. Unfortunately, in Britain, Labour and Conservative got desperately poor policies on it. Lib Dem membership are always quite keen on legalisation, but then they get slapped down by the leadership at the top. Green Party policy broadly is following the Dutch policy of licensed supply, allowing people to grow their own cannabis clubs, these sort of things. Similar sort of things are happening in Portugal and Spain at the moment. So the dam is breaking. Things are starting to move in the right direction. Unfortunately, in Britain, we are pretty behind the times on this. But I think as more and more states in United States legalize, the governments and the establishment here won't be able to ignore it any longer. So I think that's enough waffle for me. Let's have some questions and comments, please. Evening, Brenton.
Benefited from medicinal cannabis oil in post chemo and so on. What would you say about that?
Fascinating area of medical research at the moment. It really is. There is a growing body of pretty solid medical research that cannabinoids retard the growth of tumours. It's something to do with mopping up the free radicals in the body that make allow the tumours to grow. I don't know the exact science of it, but there is a growing body of medical opinion to support this. And in Canada in particular, cannabis oil is being used very effectively. I think it's Don Simpson. Rick Simpson, that's right. It just seems so obvious, and yet we have the government spending huge amounts on Sativex, which is a sort of fake cannabis that is extremely expensive. A medical corporation spends years researching on it, and yet, the drug is free. You just plant the right seeds. I think it is a very key area. Lots of anecdotal evidence and lots of research evidence that the effect of cannabis oil on cancers is extremely positive. And also after chemotherapy, one of the main problems of chemotherapy is you don't want to eat, you feel grotty. And one of the great things about weed is that it gives you the munchies. And anything that encourages humans to take on fuel and sustenance can only be a good thing. And in particular, for you in a pretty grim state after chemotherapy, it's very useful for getting the appetite back, as well as glaucoma and anti-emetic to stop you throwing up. There's a multitude of uses.
Hi. All right, Shane. Great chat. Nice fun. I just wanted to say, talking about Britain, governmental-wise, it's very slow, but there's some really good organisations, NGOs in the UK, that if you're interested, UPA, United Patients Alliance, they've set up and they're very active in looking at medical cannabis. They're run by a guy who suffers from MS. Another good organisation I'd recommend is Normal UK. So they have another part of them, which is UK Cannabis Social Club. So these are people who are, whilst we have, from the top down, we have governmental, people putting pressure, there's also people at grassroots just beginning to try and just do it, just, as if the law has changed. Another good organisation is Transform. who have created a booklet, How to Regulate Cannabis, because obviously once, if we do legalise, we need to look at how we would set it up. We obviously don't want corporate control, so the state's going to have to be involved somehow. And lastly, I'd just like to say, cannabis is also hemp. So not only can we use the flowers for medicine and recreation, we could grow strains to clothe ourselves, feed ourselves, and build our houses. So we need to be a bit almost evangelical about this plant, because whilst it's not the solution to a lot of problems, it's one of the key elements to transition into a sustainable future. I'd just like to say that.
Thank you. And maybe if people could just introduce themselves, because there's a lot of people doing good stuff. That was Jules from the Green Party Drugs Group. It's nice to meet you, actually, at last. We've been emailing for years, but let's have a drink in the bar afterwards. And Sheila.
Hello.
My
name's Sheila. I live in Streatham, South London. I've trained for years. My relatives live in Oregon, Portland, and I just came back from a visit, and I stopped in British Columbia in Vancouver, and it's completely legal there. And they've got, I only came across three, but there are three shops selling cannabis with big signs in the windows and pictures, and you go inside and they've got it all arranged by different types. And I think it's supposed to be medical there, but it doesn't look like it's medical when you go into the shop. And then in Oregon, they've just changed the law, I think, because it was... they could have medical use of cannabis, but now they can have recreational use, and it's just being changed. And it just happens that my niece and her husband are growing cannabis legally in eastern Oregon, and they've got a big production, and it's called Oregrown. So it's like Oregon on its Oregrown, and you can look it up, and there's a website, and it tells you all these different varieties. And they do medical cannabis and also recreational. And I was asking her about it, and she says that the medical stuff they grow indoors, so they don't have to... it can't be polluted by any kind of pesticides or anything else. And the, you know, the recreational, they grow outside, and I don't know if they use pesticides, but whatever. So anyway, so it's a big operation, and it's going to be right. Even bigger someday, soon.
Hello, I'm called Erica. I'm just a hippie. Not I'm doing anything else other than being a hippie.
It's a busy job.
I know. Somebody's got to do it.
Yeah.
The things that I've been watching on the amazing internet, that are coming out from California in particular, is it seems to be with the legalization and the medical use and calling it a medicine. It's my medicine that's treating something. And even recreational use starts to look like, actually, this is the treatment for my depression. I'm happy because I'm stoned. Yeah, oh, great. Yeah, so yeah, that's why not? It's making you happy. If it's getting you through the day, then it is medical. And I love the way that the Californians are just taking on this is my medicine. And it's medicine for the people. And I've seen so many growers say, we want clean medicine for the people. And it seems to be so connected with a lot of sustainable living, a lot of kind of brilliant ideas that we're here for. And I love that it's kind of interwoven with that. It hasn't become corporate yet.
But I think, you know, it's very important that it hasn't become corporate. And it, certainly in the Green Party, when we came up with our cannabis policy, we spent a long time debating, how do we keep the corporations out? We don't want a completely open, free, unregulated market where, you know, corporations could be knocking out weed in Tesco's. You know, obviously, alcohol is legal now, but it's not legal for you to stand on the street corner selling it. You need a license. Similarly, we argue you should need a license to sell cannabis, but it should be very specific licenses to very particular places. And there should be no advertising. Now, that's the main way of keeping corporations out of it, stopping them advertising and creating brand awareness and all this sort of PR side of it. So, you know, small-scale supply, small-scale production. The Home Office came out with Home Office-funded report suggesting there was around 500,000 people in Britain involved in, you know, the production, distribution, this sort of thing of drugs. I don't know what percentage of them for cannabis. It would certainly be a bigger percentage. But, you know, we don't want to squeeze the wee people out of it who are making a small but not huge living from it. We need to regulate to ensure that they still are allowed to carry on legally, obviously, so that any disputes can be settled in the small claims court and not on the baseball pitch. So, yes, you know, we're definitely not talking about an open market, an unregulated market. Legalization is maybe regulation and control is a slightly better way of looking at it. Certainly that's how Transform talk about it. And there's a few of their booklets I've put by the A-frame board there. Transform really are excellent on the different types of regulated legalization we could have.
Hi, Shane. Robin Scott. We're old friends from Newbury.
Absolutely. Yes.
I have a question for you, my friend. Excellent presentation, if I may say so. I wonder if you agree that Jeremy Corbyn, who now seems quite likely to become the next Labour leader, which I personally find a very interesting and encouraging development, and he has a very radical agenda, which curiously is supported by about 60% of the population. And he's, as you know, gathering huge amounts of grassroots support. Do you think perhaps we're going to see, if he's successful, a change in policy from the Labour Party, because he's definitely against the war on drugs?
Is that right?
I checked today.
Oh, really? Oh, interesting. We were talking about this yesterday in the panel discussion about the Corbyn and the excitement that Corbyn has brought to the table, and you know, for me as a Green, the excitement is that he, at last, someone in the Labour Party is questioning neoliberal economic theory, that idea that businesses can run things more efficiently than the state. And we're not talking about for everything, but for the sort of commanding heights of the economy sort of thing, you know, water, power, national health, housing, education, these should be run by the people, for the common good. There shouldn't be a profit motive involved in it. So from that point of view as a Green, it's really exciting seeing that that bastion of neoliberalism, you know, New Labour and the Labour Party at last are getting back to some of their roots. And I think that, so certainly in that side of it, there's definitely room for excitement. On the sort of climate change issue and his understanding of climate change, energy, peak oil, this sort of thing, he's definitely not so progressive there. And it's worth remembering that his brother, Piers Corbyn, who's a wonderful activist in many ways on the Haygate estate in South London, but he also believes that climate change is not to do with humans. He thinks it's, you know, not anthropocentric. So Jeremy Corbyn is getting some fairly off-kilter climate change denying from his family dinner table. So I definitely remain to be convinced on his sort of green credentials, but on his attitudes to austerity and challenging neoliberalism, I think is fascinating. And it's great to hear also that he is against the war on drugs and hopefully therefore in favour of some sort of, well, legalisation as opposed to decriminalisation and fiddling about with classification. But no, it's fascinating. I think it's really interesting times, because I have despaired of the Labour Party ever since they ditched unilateralism in the 80s. You know, in Lambeth, Labour have always been the opposition to progressive goings-on, green goings-on in Lambeth. And it's fascinating to see them inventing this system that is going to change them in ways that they just had no idea. It's great. And the more the right-wing media say he's a loony left, the more loads of pissed-off people think, ah, right, good then, you know. If they don't like him, then we've got to have something in common.
Shane, we've got a question over here.
I mean, it's not so much a question. My name is Duncan. I'm from Bristol. Nice to meet you guys. I just wanted to kind of point out, really, that the Declaration of Independence was actually written on the hemp paper. So, and all of these guys, they owned farms of cannabis, and they used to print a lot of their paper. All the paper before 1910 was printed in hemp books, yeah, right, which wouldn't biodegrade like the current books that we have now. because they're used through a process of just wood and stuff from Brazil and that. But I just wanted to point out it's actually intrinsically linked with the 1850s and the Rockefeller's campaign to stop hermetic medicine and to a shift towards synthetics. And that's actually intrinsically linked in a lot of this stuff. I mean, you've got 20, maybe 14 to 20 holistic doctors, and this one guy who's just discovered a cure for cancer called GMAF, and he's just been shot in a river in America this year. I mean, this is a campaign that's the same with bankers. Last year, you had 80 bankers dropping off dead. Obviously, some of it was supposedly suicide. But what we're getting back to Tony's point is earlier, and what you were saying. And even the agenda, this globalist agenda of so-called climate change, I find it stifling. It's oversaturation, and like, you know what I mean, you don't know where to turn. Obviously, the planet is being damaged, and there's a lot of, you know. But I mean, what would your answer be to that in terms of how to address this absurd kind of push towards, in a way, like ill-found logic, where it's the way they're using their argument is to actually completely offset what you say with something that's not logical at all, and it's used for their devices from terms of the petrol industry or the banking industry, or do you know what I mean? And there's loads of NGOs that are all corrupt as well, and I'm sure you know. But yeah, thank you.
Thanks for that. Sorry, I'm not trying to cut you off, but I'm sure there'll be other questions.
Yeah, I mean, as well as being a sort of an argument about whether it's good for you or not, there's a huge economic argument underneath, which in the 1800s, early 1900s, cannabis looked like it might provide a sort of an alternative to, to plastics and DuPont Corporation then inventing plastics from oils. And there was lots of economic battles going on, which I think you could go into in far greater detail than we've probably got time for now. But I mean, it's interesting about in America how cannabis is seen as sort of, it's not seen so much on the economics levels that you're talking about, which is certainly the underlying reasons why it was banned originally. But there it's much more a cultural thing. You know, cannabis became totemic of the counterculture in the States, which focused around Vietnam and the war in Vietnam. And, you know, the phenomenal goings on in the United States in the 70s, which have been absolutely airbrushed out of history. You know, we don't hear now that in most American cities in the 70s, you know, there were riots, there were demonstrations, there were firebombings. As well as counter-intel pro, you know, the state reacting back, assassinating Black Panthers, fitting them up, incarcerating them for decades. You know, there was a real cultural battle going on, which cannabis became absolutely emblematic of. And that's why in the States, amongst the sort of old right-wing Republicans, they're still so set in their ways against cannabis, but, you know, that generation are getting older and dying out. So things are starting to change there. But yeah, you know, I think underneath, originally, it was an economic battle which DuPont and Anslinger won.
My name's Brenton. I'm from South London. So Shane, do you think we should, in answer to when you were saying about the corporates, making sure that they don't get hold of it, would it be an idea then for everyone to have home starter kits so that we could actually...
On the NHS. Yes.
as a way to stopping the corporates from getting, I think for me. There you go. Right. So I think that's probably the starting point. If we all had home starter kits and we just kept the community of our streets.
We did a great little action in Primrose Hill one time. We put loads of cannabis seeds in helium balloons. And we spent the whole morning blowing up all these helium balloons with loads of cannabis seeds on, a little message from the Green Party drugs group attached. And on one side, we let these hundreds of balloons off, and they floated off over London. And eventually, the helium would escape through the latex. The seeds inside would land, hopefully, in a field, and cannabis forests would be springing up. But it is a seed. It is as simple as growing a tomato. You can get far more complicated, obviously, but certainly a system that allowed home growing. I think it would be ultimately for the environmental effects, doing it outdoors rather than under lights, which has a huge carbon footprint.
Is there a strain of seed where you can actually have a window box and actually, you know, and if anything's walking by, you just tear it off.
And
there you go.
I'm not sure. There are now lots of seeds that grow, plants that are very, very small that grow very, very quickly. So it would be possible to do it for a reasonable amount outside and then store it to keep you going throughout winter. But I think ultimately, you know, getting money out of the transaction or out of the use is definitely something to aim for, and something to also avoid is having a system which allows corporations to take it over, advertise it, create a want, and you know, it would be desperate if Coca-Cola moved on to weed and we had loads of kids bonged out all the time because it was legal. But that's, you know.
Shane, I think we might be out of time. I don't think there are any hands up, and I can see Paul has arrived, so it might be time to say a big thank you to Shane Collins for that presentation.
Thank you very much. And, do have a chat with Jules from the Green Party drugs group at the back, and we'll be in the bar afterwards. But we've got conference coming up in Bournemouth. Green surge, it's happening, and hopefully we can bring the drugs debate onto a bigger political platform as well. Thank you for coming.